Thank you. Thank you. Come on, would you verbalize that faith right now? Would you just declare it right now? Would you speak it right now? I trust that you are healer, Jesus. I trust that you are provider, God. I know that you are a way maker. I have seen you do it time and time again. And I will see you do it again. We believe, God. We believe you for our lives. We believe you for our marriages, for our homes. We believe you for our wealth. We believe you, God. We believe you, God. We believe you, God. But I say we believe you, God. We believe you, Lord. So grateful. So thankful for the presence of God. This atmosphere. I'm grateful to be in the presence of God today. So thankful for what we feel in this room. So thankful that we are in the atmosphere of our Heavenly Father surrounded with our brothers and sisters. What a joy it is. What a joy it is to be out of life's chapel on a really Sunday morning. There's just no telling what God's going to do here again. There's just no telling. I find myself at the airport just about every weekend. And so that means waiting for that notification of all notifications. Now, some of you might be friends that you're blessed to your booty. And when you fly, you pay for first class. You point and pay for first class. But every now and then, sometimes, if I got an extra favor, I get that notification that I have to upgrade to first class. I just want you to know, first class just feels a whole lot different when you have to pay for first class. That view is just a little better. You can have to pay $450 for it, or $640 or whatever. And I'm telling you, you walk in those doors when you get that notification. You start up your game over. So I had the notification. I got the notification that I was offering the first class. I'm going to carry it out into that day. I didn't even stop to buy overpriced tickets at the airport because I knew I was going to be in first class. But I think that's going to be a great night. And so they called for everybody to come from those things. Daddies, they called for those with children, they called for those with the military, they called for those with special assistance, they called everybody but I got 12 flights in service. Get near to him, to provoke him, to keep him from pushing back, to keep him from losing his uniform. Say, my father, it will be a visit with a dear moment, with respect, that the church can all celebrate this moment, and that they're wanting to do anything to stop him from pushing back. And said, my father, you're the prophet that I can do a great thing. Would you have done it? You would have. How much greater than what you just asked to do something simple and small, why should we do it? That's how profound it felt. Upon Naaman, the Bible says, Naaman went down and touched himself seven times by the river Jordan, according to his vanity. No. According to positive energy. No. According to good vibes only. No. So he returned to the man of God, all his company and kings, and stood before him, and he said, behold, now I know that there is no God in all the earth but in Israel. So I pray that would you take a blessing? You got Apple Pay, you got this phone, you got PayPal. I want to be a blessing to you. He's excited for this new miracle he's going to lay hold. The prophet says, verse 16. As the Lord liveth, my father might say, I have received that. Surely he's going to take it as he receives it. So Naaman said, well, if you won't receive it in return, then I will accept it from you. Shall it not be your mouth making to give it to your servant? Two mules overflowing, two mules loaded down with it. So for the next few moments, I want to preach to you, I want to teach to you, I want to bring that to you. I want to talk to you on this simple structure, deliverance with a sign of terror. Deliverance with a sign of terror. Would you tell your neighbor, deliverance with a sign of terror? Would you turn to your other neighbor, the one you just rejected? And would you tell them, deliverance with a sign of terror? And you can be seated this morning. The Bible says that Naaman was a great man. He was a mighty man of valor. Naaman was the goat. Naaman was not a man to be messed with. He was a conqueror. He was a warrior. Naaman knew how to win. Think about it. Every battle that he walked into, he walked out of. It didn't matter the service, it didn't matter the war, it didn't matter the blood and guts, it didn't matter what took place. Naaman always seeks to walk out victorious. Only W for Naaman. Naaman doesn't take that. It just doesn't move. How many of you like to win? How many of you like to lose? That's not what you're wanting. Because it's not what you have to raise with people with. Me and my cousin, we grew up playing basketball, we grew up playing softball, we grew up playing street hockey, we grew up playing football, we grew up playing volleyball, checkers, chess. But we preferred to play something that you know you could almost knock them down, you could give somebody a breeze, somebody could go home with a great game. Whatever we were going to play, we were going to play it, and we were going to play the tough and rough and hard. We like to win. And so I wanted to play this game. I like to win. Now, but what that means is, those of us that don't always like to win, now we're not going to say it. We're not going to confess. I have to like to lose. And nobody wins that game. I'm going to replace somebody. And that's just it. When you're living in love, you win. You win this. You win this. So I want to play that to the person. I'm going to get this basketball because if they don't love him, he's going to lose your own face. I don't just love him. That's all that happened to me. Have you ever heard? I mean, it's like somebody, have you ever had someone that likes to fit? We grew up fisting growing up. Got fishing for bass, and that's what I was doing. Somebody would start for fishing, and it's like, what? Did you catch anything? Didn't catch no fish, but we caught a good time. If you can have a good time with a snake, you can have a good time with it. Not catching anything. I love you. That's what I'm expecting. I want to go there right with you, but just don't want to touch it, don't want you to be a teammate when we play ball. All I can do is, and almost no matter what team the likes to win, and the team is just always winning, and even not losing. But the Bible says that David, this great man, making him this military leader, making him this victorious conqueror, but so much that even the people look at God. His victory. This same David not only has leprosy, and it does not matter how much you win. At some point in life, you will find yourself as a victim. There will be something that you cannot overcome in your own ingenuity, in your own intellect, in your own power, in your own mind. There will be something that you it's a traumatic disease, it's an incurable disease in all kinds of things. You can fight the leprosy, it would literally perform your funeral before you die. Don't cast you out of society. I mean, all this sickness is a stigma. I must proclaim you to be left on the house. To anybody that you even dare get close to you. But between kind of all that problem, it's so ravishing, it's so horrific that it would literally kill you from the inside out as you would die in slow, horrific death. And one day a piece of your ear would fall off, one day a piece of your jaw, a piece of your body, little by little you would decay. And so it is that no matter how much you can hide it, there comes a moment when you cannot hide it any longer because leprosy is slowly taking over. Leprosy will not listen to Naaman. Naaman tells everybody what to do. He tells everybody what to do. Everybody has to listen to Naaman, but leprosy will not listen. He doesn't have control over it. He's beyond his control. The Bible says that this is somebody in Naaman's people. They have a testimony. I want you to hear this. I want you to freestyle this in your spirit because I think it's so intriguing. I see Naaman coming back home, and he's seeing the armor's coming off, and the tape is coming off, and it doesn't matter how much he is winning. Publicly, he's losing more and more privately. It doesn't matter how much success he has out there, he's always coming back to defeat his fear. The Bible says about this slave girl, she is a hostage. She has been taken from her land. She has been taken from her people. She has been taken captive from Naaman. And she hears that he has leprosy. And she does not to do what a woman does. Can I just get back to you this morning? Can I confess to you this morning? What I mean to say is, can I confess to you and do not judge me? I'm trying to preach the table this morning, so if you're going to think any of us, then go on. I'm told you, put on your seat, go home and build it. I got to be real and I got to preach to my people. Is that all right?
Yeah.
Hunger. And I've been taken from my people. I've been taken from the land of Chick-fil-A. I am here to take some. And I hear that my people have never seen. Where are you going? Pastor, take out all the prayer list and go, this is a prayer, this is a prayer. Do I need to hear the God is good. If David could ever be my God, and if David could ever have an encounter with the prophet, that possibility would not be impossible. Supernatural could be a reality. Thank you. the point of the thing. What is a palace without faith? What is gold without faith? What is a throne without faith? There is a slave girl that has nothing seemingly. I guess she still has her joy, she still has her peace, she still has her relationship with God. And there is a king that is panicking, saying, "Oh, I don't know what to do." You don't need everything perfect in your life to have faith. God can meet you right where you are and bring joy and restoration and resilience to your life. So now the king of Israel and his kingdom was before the trouble of the bring him. Bring him. Bring him to my house. First, he brought him to the house. So if you bring him to the heavenly throne, that will be an answer. So Solomon comes with the camel, he comes with the camel, he comes with the snacks, he's got the yelling, he's got the cheeses, he's got the inner room, he's the whole entourage, and everybody's now comes to the prophet's house. And if you think that doing this job is, you wait until you meet the prophet, because you're not going to meet the prophet. The prophet doesn't even come out of his house. He sends out the rookie prophet. You got to realize, the last time that he came, that he killed everybody, what were you doing to imagine? There is no produce. There is no party tables. There is no party showcase. There is no welcome back there. Everybody's working. Everybody's sleeping. No, what is the anger doing? How's your kids? How's your dog? Mary, you've got your kids. Come on. Thank you. start doing all, you'll just start buying stuff that you don't even need. You don't even have a budget for. But then you come into the house of God and the Lord just impresses you to give a little bit more of the offering. Financially smart for me to give 30 extra dollars today. I cannot be the wife of God. You ever notice the stuff that we're enthusiastic about? We'll get so excited about somebody throwing a ball and making a touchdown. And we'll go from throwing Jehovah to our mind. And then we go into the house of God. The pastor says, we only can come and exceed great grace. And something says, more dignified than you able to be. Our pride is not like you. Our pride lies. Management is about possessing miracles. But what? The rest of my life is not to provoke you. So just like you have me, just like you have a pastor wife, just like God and all my men, many women have to come into your life and to provoke you to good works. Sometimes the supernatural is supernatural. Sometimes I think that it's a little easier to be extreme than it is to be consistent. What happens when that still small voice speaks to you? Does not so far off and distant that we don't hear it. It's so close that we miss it.
Right.
That still small voice. The Bible says that it was a little boy. It was this young slave boy that was used by God to promote the journey of Deliverance. And Deliverance that was standing at the brink of the river. You only just cast it as something small and something little. Are you going to do it? Or are you going to stay down? Because your pride was gone. But your pride was the best to big things.
we
have this pseudo procrastination. I'm not going to God in his name to God in his name to go down on the mountain. What about when God asks you just to tell somebody that's part of your body? There's a new beginning. enemy is trying to convince you is so great. It's too great. It's too much. God's asking too much. I don't remember. God just asked him to stop them. God is asking you to be a steward of the will of the Lord. Well, I don't think as a 7,000 man, you probably have to die or something. He's used to be green king. He's probably a demon. That might have to die 1,000 years. Maybe they don't have any time. He's smoking. He's trying to get out of that. Probably gross. Might even enjoy it. But the story can stand. What that means can't stand. We're giving back. It's already his. It's already been purchased. Everything we need, our salvation, our healing, our restoration, we give back to him. And it's not, oh, I don't pay you for this, but you can put a price on something priceless. God said, I don't want to see this thing for you. So they just said, I want to talk to us, but I want to talk to you. And so I want to do it. I'm going to move on from this moment. I need a piece of this moment to move on with me. I'm not going to stay in this room. I need a piece of this room to stay with me. See, 1 Corinthians 3:24. Sunday morning only religions, but you come and you're getting changed and you feel a little God and you leave it there and you go back home. Then towards your own desires and your own weaknesses and you're overcome by this and you're taken captive by this and you come back with something and you banish God, you overcome from God. And then you leave him again. Every time within four walls. The New Testament Christianity says no God that's with you. He kills you. He empowers you. He has our blood shed. I'll never forget. I was in a service. There's a man came up for prayer and he said, "Would you pray for me?" I will confess to you this morning, I'm praying one of the most stupid prayers I've ever prayed. I guess it wasn't so stupid. If my mom was watching, I would have clicked it off. It wouldn't say stupid in my life. I prayed one of the most unwise prayers. One of the most stupid, unwise prayers. You know what I prayed? God, I want you to touch my boss. I want you to look at me. I want you to hear me. Nothing wrong with any of those things. But that person was in the righteous life. Fear, darkness, torment, it was suicidal. And when you have that person, you need more than a job promotion. You need more than Sunday night. You need more than religiosity. And then you hear something about the story. He said that to his church. I said, so wrong as they're not. I said, is this true? He said, yes. I said, you need the Spirit of God. You need the Holy Ghost. He said, yes, that's what I want. I said, that's what you're doing. He said, it's no big thing. I'm going to pray for you. You can get a picture of heavenly lands. Let God fill you with the Spirit. And I'll never forget his performance. He said, I'm not 41 anymore. I feel like I'm 1 year old. The Bible said, Nathan came out of the skin of a little child. He was a new beginning. He was a new beginning. I'm preaching this to somebody. There is a new beginning. There is a new beginning. Come on, it's not just going to be a new year. It can be a new time. And a new time. This is why I'm going to spirit of the family.
ready to pray together. My brothers and sisters, I want you to come. If you're in the front, I want you to come as close as you can so people behind you can come. We're about to conclude this service with faith. After we're about to conclude this service with faith, it was more than just a song. No, we truly believe it. I said we truly believe that God can heal any diagnosis. We do believe that God can open up a door financially. But we also believe God can forgive you of the guilt of the condemnation. I believe somebody today can be renewed in the Spirit. I believe somebody today can be healed for the very first time. I believe somebody in this room can hear me right now. Maybe you're watching online. Maybe you're in this place where God would begin with you to be baptized in His name. Everything in your mind just feels like, oh, that's just the way our life chapel does. That's just Pastor wants to persuade another. No. It's in the Word. We're not here to align ourselves to a cult. We're not here to align ourselves to a religious code of conduct, to preferences. We're not here to align ourselves to what past generations of our family thought. No, I've got to align myself to the Word. And His Word invites me to repent. His Word invites me to be baptized in His name and have every sin washed away. His Word invites me to be made whole. I don't have to go back home to a losing battle. I don't have to impress you. I don't have to hide. I don't have to fool you. I don't have to walk empty. I don't have to walk with loss and weight. His Word invites us to be filled with His Spirit, to be renewed. So you know what we're going to do right now in the family. God's time is almost done. But we're going to pray together as a family. And we're just going to ask the Lord to forgive us. I don't pray because I'm spiritual. I pray because I'm primal. And I pray because I'm human. And that is a little bit more than it normally is. Have you ever been tempted to read a story in the Bible and you always project yourself into the story? How do I put myself into the story? Everything that's readable in this book is livable. It's not fear, it's not the ether, it's real. But you know what happens when I put myself in the story? I always put myself in the story as the best character. Every time I'm that girl, I have a testimony. I'm never in it. There's a little bit of that in my life. Whatever that is for me, whatever that legacy represents, whatever that life, whatever that cause, whatever that failure, that mistake, that picture, that word, whatever it is, whatever the pain is. On the other side of the simple faith, on the other side of that still small voice, is complete deliverance. It's all of it. All of it. So we're going to ask the Lord to forgive us right now. Would that be all right? We're going to ask the Lord to forgive us. Did you know what the Bible says? The Bible says He is faithful to forgive. That's consistency. The Bible says He is ready to forgive. We're going to ask the Lord to forgive us. We're not going to twist His arm. We're not going to get tripped up. We're going to ask Him to forgive us, to cleanse us. And if you've never been baptized in the name of Jesus, I'm telling you, this is your signal. This is your confirmation. I'm going to pray about it. Prayers can be professional. I need to think about it. There's some things I don't need to think about when He's done it. And when He's disclosed it. And when He's already revealed it. I'm telling somebody, maybe you're watching all time. If you've never been baptized, I remember how I was baptized. It's not being baptized. I know it was false baptized. I don't know if it was the exact way it was in Scripture. It's worth being rebaptized. Not my temple window, but the way. If you've never received the gift of God's Spirit, how can we ask the Lord to forgive us? We're going to lift up our hands. We're not going to hold our hands down. We're not going to hold our hands down. We're going to lift up our hands and our hands of faith and expectancy. We're going to begin to open our mouth and worship. We're going to begin to open our mouth and praise and thanksgiving. I'm telling you, it's not hard, it's not complicated, it's simple. It's so simple that we make it hard. But if you've never been through this dream, I'm telling you, God can take it just like that. You're saying, God, I love you, God, I worship you, God, I pray for you. That His presence can come in your heart. You don't want to overflow out of your mouth. You have a decision. You're going to feel your tongue want to move. You're going to feel you want to take control. And you can open up your wallet. You can put your hands in your pocket. You can go home. You can be in control. And you can do whatever God wants. You can heal. And you can let that person flow out of you. And God can fill you just like that. You know what the Bible, you know what the Bible says? It's joy unspeakable. How you think about something that's unspeakable. And you know the best part? God wants to minister collectively, but He also wants to minister individually. So we're going to talk about God what He does. I believe God can do whatever you need Him to do. So if you're all right, we're not going to take 2 hours, we're not going to take the rest of the day, we're not going to rush God, but we're not going to spend around. Every word. He's an angel. He's a devil. He's a way maker. He's a hero. So I just believe it's so much about the truth in this room. We're not going to rush God. We're not going to pray until 5 hours. We're not going to be here all day. We're about to release our faith. And God, who's already been moving in this room, is going to manifest Himself even stronger. And we're just going to make Him do whatever He wants to do. Do we have time for that? Do we have time for that? I want God to do it. So we're going to let Him do it. All right? I want to invite you. Would you just lift your hands all across the sanctuary? Would you close your eyes? Would you begin to ask the Lord to forgive you? Come on, would you repent with me, with your brothers and your sisters in your own way? Would you just say, God, I need you all over again. God, I need you to forgive me. I need you to cleanse me. I need you to wash me. I surrender everything that I am to you. I surrender everything that I am not to you. God, I surrender the pain. I surrender the anger. I surrender the greed. I surrender the dishonesty. I surrender the apathy. I surrender the lust. I surrender the comparison. God, forgive me for not leaning on you. Forgive me of my doubt. Forgive me of my religiosity, God. Forgive me of my coldness, God. Forgive me of my pride. God, open up my heart to you all over again. I don't want any sin to get in the way of what you're wanting to do in my life. I don't want any weight to hold me back. Come on, it's just beautiful. Come on, for just another moment, I want you to surrender to God. Don't worry about anybody else. Come on, we're about to release our faith. We're about to release our worship. But right now, we're making some decisions. Come on, we're stepping out of death. We're stepping out of fear. We're stepping out of leprosy. We're stepping back into alignment with His Word. We're listening to that still small voice. We're opening our heart. We're opening His Word. Come on, His mercy is here right now.